Thanks for waiting. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our second webinar on data governance. My name is Philippe. I'm working as senior manager for DataShift, mainly on data governance projects. And on the other screen is Martijn, data governance consultant at DataShift, currently working in Antwerp. And together we will guide you through this webinar today. For those who don't know DataShift yet, DataShift was founded 5 years ago. We are specialized in data governance, business intelligence, and data science and engineering. And we aim to bridge the gap between business consultancy and data engineering. Two remarks for today. First of all, this session is recorded, so we can share it with you afterwards. And secondly, you are all on mute, but feel free to answer questions via the Q&A form. We will closely monitor these questions and, if feasible, answer them during the session. Otherwise, it will be at the end of the session. Today, we will further explore data governance. These days, most companies are sitting on heaps of information and data. And as mentioned yesterday by Ursula von der Leyen on the State of the European Union, a lot of this data is never used. So a lot of companies have a lot of data, but they don't use it. If you want to analyze this data, so if you are the 20% of users who uses this data, you should get your basics right. So before you start analyzing your data, you must make sure your basics are right, because the biggest reason investments in big data or data used to fail is that most companies don't do a good job with your information they already have. They don't know what data they have or what the information means. Nobody's feeling responsible for the data, but you just expect people to trust information they receive, for example, on a financial report. And if this the data in this report is based on data you don't know where it's coming from or who's governing it, I think it's better to trust your gut feeling instead of the data in this report. And most important thing as well, a lot of people think that only big companies are using or having a lot of data. But what do you think about the data behind the web shop of your local bakery or the website of a bar? Both are collecting valuable information. When analyzed, it can potentially increase their revenues. Important as well is that companies don't magically develop competences to monetize data just because they collect data and invest in high-end analytics tools. Until a company learns how to convert their data, trust their data, it will not be in a position to benefit from big data. So it's a change management process, governing data. And that's an important thing as well. It will not come in your company as from day one. No, it's a step-based approach you have to apply to make sure you can get value out of your data. Today, as already mentioned, we will further guide you through data governance. We will first start with a short recap of our first webinar on data governance, which took place in the beginning of July. After that, we will focus on three data governance subject areas which were chosen based on the feedback of the first webinar. And then we will do a short wrap-up and we have some time for Q&A. After these sessions, we want you to have an idea what the three data governance subject areas we cover today mean, so that you are able to search in your organizations for opportunities to apply for it. Martijn, go ahead.
Thank you, Philippe, for the introduction. I will quickly recap the last session in a few minutes. So as some of you may recall, Evert started his presentation by sharing some statistics like the amount of searches Google handles per day, 1.2 trillion, or the number of people that were online on a specific day, 4.5 billion. Also Ursula von der Leyen mentioned in her State of the Union, just to show you that we can't properly grasp the volumes of data, let alone that we can understand the value of the data and find valuable insights. On the other hand, our competitive organizations seeing this as an opportunity to acknowledge the digital needs of their customers. by, amongst others, investing in data technologies. Like we all know Google, Amazon, Netflix, but also like Philips Bakery, smaller organizations are investing time in by introducing, for example, web shops. This to conclude that the current data growth provides a lot of risks to organizations to lose their competitive edge, but also it provides just as much, if not more, opportunities to gain an edge and to better serve their customers, so that you can create a win-win for your organization on the one hand and your customers on the other. But let's go to the next slide and quickly recap the key drivers to start doing data governance. So the first one as an organization, you would like to mitigate risk and ensure that you are compliant with regulations like GDPR or BCBS in the banking world. But why not go a step further and seize this moment by using data governance to optimize processes so that you can get data faster, ensure that the data is reliable and of a high quality, so that you can make the correct decision in a shorter time frame. And of course, a lot of data data-driven processes don't manage to land because the foundation, the data governance, doesn't exist. So if you have that data governance foundation, you can start making decisions based on information you have and not only based on your gut feeling. That brings us to the definition of data governance. So we consider data governance as being the process of managing proactively the availability, usability, and security of data, usage by creating and implementing processes, standards, and procedures on the one hand, and providing expertise on data management on the other. If you want to find out more on how we ended up at this definition of data governance, I recommend you to watch the recording of the last session. Also, something I would like to mention here is that there are three critical components, which are the technologies at an enterprise that are using data, the processes that consume and produce data, so maybe supported by these technologies, and the most important actor, the people. They are the ones that will have to change their habits to start properly using and maintaining their data. But let's start and show you some new content. This time we will focus on other data subject areas. So last time we mentioned the data quality, business glossary, and roles and responsibilities. But this time we will learn you more about the operating model, reference data, and the data catalog. With these, we will try to make clear how people, processes, and technologies fit into them and how you can start improving your data governance at your organization. Please let us know where we should focus on next time. That could be another subject area like data lineage, but it could also be, for example, more in-depth, a question regarding your data governance roadmap or how to build a data strategy. Okay, let me give the floor to Philippe.
So the the first subject area we will cover is reference data. Reference data is data used to classify or categorize information. It is data that doesn't change often and is used in a lot of different processes and systems. As you can see on this boarding card on the screen, reference data can be everywhere. For example, the title of the person, the doctor, the gate number K32, the seat number 13D, the airport code LGA. Those are all reference data. And to put it simple, this is what you usually find in a drop-down list. Sometimes you will select a value, for example, the airport New York LaGuardia. And in the system, this will be presented by the code LGA. Important as well is that reference data can both originate from internal or external sources. Internal sources are defined within an organization, For example, the gate number above, that's an internal source, because gate K32 at New York LaGuardia will not be the same as gate K32 at Los Angeles, or maybe it doesn't exist at Los Angeles. So as well for the seat number 13D, it depends on the airline and the type of aircraft. You as well have external sources, and those are located outside of your organization. And for example, on this boarding card, the airport codes, LGA for New York LaGuardia, is a code which is defined by IATA, the International Air Transport Association. You also have ISO standards, for example, for country codes. So those are external sources. We will take another example in the aviation to explain to you what reference data is. And for example, we have the airline British Airways, which is also known as BA. But it was established in 1974 as a merger of those two companies, BOAC and BEA. So the British European Airways and the British Overseas Airways Corporation. Then in 1982, British Caledonian was added to it. In 2011, they merged with Iberia to International Airlines Group, also known as EIG. And in 2012, British Midland was added to this group as well. Moody's and Standard & Poor's are giving this number to EIG. For financial transactions, we have this ISIN number. It also has a VAT number. And all of them, they are referring to British Airways. And this just as an example that if you don't have a single and accurate view on your customer, you could lose a sale because you didn't know all those companies were linked to each other. You could get fined by the regulator. For example, you are doing business with a company, but that company is linked to a criminal organization, for example, or you can damage your reputation. And so far, we did not take into account that all those companies or within your team or organization, all different departments can use those wrong references, and it can have a cascading effect on your analysis, on your reporting, and things like that. And important as well, it is estimated that between 20 to 50% of tables in a database, they are housing reference data. So based on these examples, we prepared a short definition of reference data. So as mentioned before, reference data is used to classify or categorize information. It is data that doesn't change often and is used in a lot of different processes and systems. As mentioned, around 20 to 50% of data in databases are reference data, and it can originate from both internal as external sources. What are the challenges enterprises are facing with reference data? First of all, it is not clear for all of them what reference data is used. So you have those internal sources, you have external sources. A lot of reference data is used, and sometimes it happens, and it can happen external, that multiple code sets are used for the same purpose. And we have an example on this slide, for example, for the country code. You have three code lists over here, ISO Alpha 2, ISO Alpha 3, and the UN code, and they all have another code value for the same country, Belgium, or for the same country, United Kingdom. And this can happen within your company as well. It can happen that Department X is using a code set to identify products, and another department is using a code set as well, but it's another code set referring to the same product. So it's important that you know how these code sets correlate to each other to make sure that if you do reporting, for example, that all those sets are linked and that you can get a clear view on the data you have, and you can get the good insights out of it. And then we didn't talk about the cross enterprise reference data. There we have to make sure that this one is reconciled as well. And now we can move on. I check the questions and answers. We don't have any on this topic, so we can move to the next subject area, Martin, the data catalog.
Thank you, Philippe. So as mentioned by Philippe, feel free to raise your questions in the Q&A section. And so the second subject area where we would like to focus on is the data catalog, where the reference data focused on the values in the drop-down list, to put it simple. Your data catalog is actually an internal up-to-date data library. That's quite vague, right? So let me explain why I use the term library. So let's imagine you are going to a library. You enter the building because in that building you know that all the information can be found. You can look for information on several ways. You can wander around. The library is structured to guide people to the book they need. This is the case because a librarian has registered all the books and placed them on a logical location, for example, ordered by age, by topic, and alphabetically. Or, if you want to save some time or don't know exactly where to find that information, you can enter some search criteria in a computer in the library. And that computer, okay, it depends on the library, but it could look for example, terms in the title, in the description of that book, maybe even in the author biography or in the reviews that someone added. If you go like a step further, it could maybe even look in the content of the book to do a matching to help you find the book you are looking for. And last but not least, there is qualified personnel that can help you with these processes to find the information you are looking for. Once you found the book, you read it, learn new things, and bring it back to the library. And the librarian updates the record and places the book best at the correct position in the library. So let's imagine you are a data scientist. To go back to another enterprise. You need to build, for example, as a data scientist, a model to predict the probability of default of a prospect. So the first thing you will do is get more insights in what data is available at the enterprise and where that information is stored. At your enterprise, there might not be such a library where you can find all that information. So you start doing it old school, and you just go out and speak to experts that will direct you to other experts, and you document everything just in a Word file that you then store somewhere on the SharePoint. That are just your notes, so that information is not validated by the people you interviewed. It does not remain accurate as your organization changes over time. So in a few months' time, a new data scientist starts, and he or she might have similar questions. So he or she could start looking at your notes, which might not be correct, or he or she starts interviewing the same experts, making a similar document. Isn't that frustrating for the interviewed experts and highly inefficient for the organization as a whole? Wouldn't it be great that you have this kind of library, that you have this central place where you can go to, where you can find all the data and all the systems of your organization? A place where you can find very easy, where data is structured in different systems and categories of data, so that you can easily find back the column or the table you're looking for. Or you can enter search criteria, and you will then be looking in the content of the description, of the definition of that certain column or of that certain table, or maybe even into the real data to find out to find the data you need. So for example, that you can easily find all the information you currently have about your clients and prospects for that model that you are building, like the probability of default, and that across all the systems. So and the third thing is there also could be some people assigned, so data roles like data custodian or data steward, who can help you with finding the answers to your questions, so that you don't need to discover the entire organization to find the expert you need. You just go to that central place and find the people you need to speak to, so the experts. And once you found that information, so we are at the book at the bottom, you can simply request access to the data if it is not public or, for example, sensitive. And then you can define like, okay, I need access to this data to build my predictive model or my model. And then the data scientist can create their model and document their findings directly into the data. So that when a new data scientist joins, the information gathered by that the data scientist is stored in this central library. Now you have two options. Either you start doing this manually, a bit like the librarian did. And you manually make sure that once new data enters the enterprise, it is correctly defined, it is stored at the right location. When it becomes obsolete, so no longer used, that you don't forget to remove that data. When you need access to, when some people have access to data that should not have access to that data, that those accesses are removed. All these processes, you can do it manually, but that won't be sufficient. Even although you might consider yourself as a small organization, that won't be sufficient, but please feel free to prove us wrong. We think you might need a tool to support you on that, a tool that can automate a lot of these tasks. So that a tool can help you to by ingesting from various sources that you have one accurate and up-to-date overview of all your data, so that you can easily search for information across columns for the model you're building, and so that you support processes like data access management and data ownership by this central tool. There are a lot of solutions on the market, so feel free to reach out if you would like to figure out which solution is best for you. So here a summary of what I just mentioned. So a data catalog is actually your internal up-to-date data library that is accessible by the entire organization. Crucial is that you should be able to find and understand all data across the organization in one accessible location. And as a foundation for people to act on that data so that you can govern that, so that you have that trusted piece of information. And here a short summary on why data should be governed. I took a simple example of a library, but here you find the enterprise challenges you might have. You might find it challenging to find which data has been used and where. You might see that some data elements are documented, like for example, some tables in your data warehouse can be documented in an Excel file, but that there is often no universal scalable approach on how to document this data. It's also not clear who to contact in case of any questions related to this physical or logical data, so that you don't know how to access this data or how to get more information. And last but not least, it also might be challenging to discover new opportunities, since all those different teams are keeping their own Excel file and are not like using that one central data catalog where they document everything.
Okay. And I'll move on to the next subject area, Martijn. The next subject area we will describe is the operating model. An operating model describes the way an organization governs their data. It's a kind of a blueprint of your data organization model. It's the as-is situation. And to give you an example on how it works, we will have first show you a quite simple example so you can get into the mindset. And afterwards, Martijn will give you some more detailed and more complex example. So imagine you are a project leader at a road contractor, Asphalt Andy. And end of next week, you are going to a construction site and you need 1,000 tons of asphalt. Because you don't know if there's enough asphalt within the company, you you send a mail to Jos from the asphalt plant and to ask him, do we have enough supplies in-house to produce 1,000 tons of asphalt by end of next week? Jos doesn't know that because all raw materials are decentralized. So he has to call all these suppliers. So he will call the supplier of the bitumen, the supplier of the stones, the supplier of the sand. So they can provide their storage. They will send him an email. Jos will bundle all this information in a report and will do some calculations. And then he will send a report with all this information in back to you, to Andy, the project leader, to confirm, yes, we have enough stock to produce 1,000 tons of asphalt. But imagine there's another project leader who also needs 500 tons of asphalt. The same process will start over again. So with this, we illustrated a kind of operating model of a data flowing through this organization. But imagine you can improve this as-is situation. Wouldn't it be easy that Andy has a catalog, and in the catalog, as Martijn just explained, he can find all data he can request and where he can obtain it and whom he should contact. It's also useful for newcomers, as Martijn mentioned. Then they know, okay, I have to call Jos, or I can look in a library or in a catalog on the SharePoint to make sure I have this data. What Jos from the asphalt plant would like to know is, okay, at the bitumen plant, the stones and the sand supplier, they are using a lot of different types of stones and all of them have their unique codes. And then we come back to the reference data we mentioned in the beginning of this session. It would be nice if Jos had an overview of all the codes that are used at the different places to make sure he orders the right material and to make sure they both use the same language. Another important thing is Jos at this stage relies on the information that's coming back from his suppliers, but it is best he gets a data sharing agreement with them to make sure that one the data is delivered in the same format. So for example, if he wants it every week in an Excel file or in a CSV file, it can be defined in a data sharing agreement between the asphalt plants and the suppliers. What else can happen? Jos notices that a lot of, This is regarding data quality, because Jos notices that the data coming from the different suppliers is not always reliable. So he wants to add some data quality rules on it to make sure that he can rely on the data, and based on that as well, that Andy knows that the data which is in his report is reliable. And to keep an eye on all the flows of this data, so in this operating model, you can visualize how the data is flowing via data lineage. So then you, for example, if you are If you take the data from the bitumen supplier, then you know how the data is flowing towards Andy. It goes via JOS, he makes some calculations on it, transfers it to a report, and then it goes to JOS. That's what we call a data lineage, and that's something you can get out of the operating model as well. And then the management of the company, of the contractor company, also would like to know the production rate of the asphalt of last week. So they send an email to Jos, for example, what was the production rate of the asphalt plant last week? But to know that, Jos must know what production rate means. And by doing this, you can define it and write it down in a business glossary, which was covered during our last session. So this is a quite simple example to explain you how you can visualize how the data is governed within your company. And this, as mentioned, was a simple example, and Martin will now guide you through a more complex one.
Thank you, Philippe. So Philippe showed you like a relatively simple example, one process at Asphalt Andy, but there could be more than 100 of these processes at a small road contractor like Asphalt Andy, or maybe even thousands of processes at the big international organizations. So what data you are having at your organization and why you should govern that data is actually the operating model. An operating model is actually the foundation of your data strategy. You need an overview of all the data you would like to govern by describing those high-level processes like Philippe did, and all the technologies and teams involved. If you have described that, you are currently governing your so-called current operating model. And then you can start about thinking, okay, let's move to a target operating model. So a future solution where you would like to go. And then you should take into account, of course, the as-is situation, maybe some external factors like regulatory pressure, and your data vision and data strategy. And take into account all those different things, and building your operating model might be challenging. So, if you are stuck, you might want to be supported by various data governance tools on the market. All of them have their pros and cons. Like for example, here you can see an example of Colibra, and there you see that they have defined like 10 steps helping you, or I see eight steps helping you design your operating model. But if you want some support during this selection phase, just like the data catalog, don't hesitate and just reach out so that we can have a short talk about that. If we take one example, because like also mentioned by Philippe, an operating model is actually a set of blueprints. And here, for example, we have a blueprint showing you the pieces of data you would like to govern and how they are related to each other. Every tool some tools provide you with like a starting point where you can find some inspiration. Like, okay, for example, it's for me very important to govern the reports and the reference data, like Philippe mentioned. Then you can like only keep that information and remove those that are not linked to those use cases, and you can start with that. So this could be a good source of information to design your own asset model. So like mentioned, we consider your operating model as the dynamic set of blueprints of your data governance foundation. As you know, your enterprise is all about data. If you're talking about your financials, the inventory of your products, services, or your clients, it's all about data. To govern this data, key subject areas were identified, like the business glossary, data quality, and the data catalog. But all of those subject areas are related to each other. How these things relate to each other is described in the operating model. To correctly govern all your data, you have to stop thinking in silos, since the entire data organizations deserves an operating model where you describe the way your organization governs your data. Introducing these processes to produce data, the technologies used and the people involved is crucial. So your current operating model and your target operating model are really the foundations of all your data stewardship and data management activities. Okay, so some enterprise challenges when we are talking about the operating model. Some people might not have a clear overview of what data is available and how this data is and should be governed. This is a challenging exercise since more and more data is being collected. And as a consequence, every team is going their own direction. Either they do nothing, or they start doing things which are not in line with the enterprise data strategy. And it's also the second thing here is that it's difficult to understand the value of the operating model. Since your data strategy might not land because there's a lack of a view of the operating model, so the current operating model, and the target operating model. You should take into account when you go towards the target operating model and your data governance roadmap to make sure that you take into account the current situation, so the operating model. And a third bullet point is that it's difficult for enterprises to create a model that successfully represents their data goals. So letting a data strategy land is not easy. Sometimes the organization is taking too much time to define the operating models, to clearly describe the operating model, to make sure it 100% fits the data strategy and all the organizational factors. But before you know, you lose the momentum and things have changed at your organization and you need to start all over again. So the third bullet point, just be pragmatic and take into account the current situation and all the other factors, but just start doing things.
Okay, thank you, Martijn. As a wrap up of this session today, we covered the operating model, reference data, data catalog. Last time we covered data quality, business glossary, roles and responsibilities. If you are interested, for example, in data lineage or any other topic regarding data governance, please feel free to contact us or to use the Q&A section. To conclude, if you manage your buildings not properly and you don't know what materials have been used and whether they were validated or not, bad things can happen. Same goes with data. If you provide financial reports based on ungoverned or unreliable data to your stakeholders or a regulator, this can have serious consequences. Same goes for the investment you decided to execute based on the forecasted market growth in your dashboard, but the information in dashboard came from an external source. You don't know where it comes from, where it came from. So all those things are quite important, and that's why data governance is very important. And for example, you have the GDPR regulation as well. If someone within your company is using the telephone number of your customers to sell them to another company without knowing that, this can have serious consequences based on the GDPR regulation. And similar as it goes with buildings, roles and responsibilities must be set up. Policies must be drawn up with your data. So some of the key questions to be answered is who's responsible for your data? Who manages it? Who maintains it? And that's those roles and responsibilities. What's the quality of your data? You're using your data in dashboards, but you don't know how reliable the data is. And maybe you take decision based on the data in your dashboards, but the data is unreliable, so the output is as well. And where does this data come from? If you buy it externally, can you trust the data? Is it reliable? How was it created? All those things can be governed in your data governance operating model. Does everyone understands where this data stands for? Do we all speak the same language? It's the business glossary. To make sure that everybody within your company knows what they are talking about, it's important to have a business glossary. And so on. You also would like to know how the data flows in your organization are managed efficiently. For example, the example of road contractor Andy, where everybody has to call Jos to know if there's enough supply available. All those things can be automated and made more efficiently. So based on an operating model or your blueprint of the as-is situation, you can identify where you can optimize those flows. This to conclude this presentation. Thank you for your attention. Now we arrive to the Q&A. We have two questions, I see. First one is, do you need all subject areas before you think about your operating model? Maybe you can handle that one, Martin.
So in general, those two things happen like in parallel. So you might already have a business glossary at your organization in a certain team, or you might already have a data catalog, so a description of all your columns and fields at a certain system. But if you want to embed this really in your organization, you have in the same time, you need to think about your target operating model. So yeah, to answer your question, you can do both in parallel so that you make sure that all those interesting subject areas stick and will be embedded in your organization. I hope okay. That answered your question.
Yeah, they are on mute, so they cannot answer. But okay, second question is, what's the difference between metadata management and data governance? That's an interesting question as well. I will give it a first try, and please correct me, Martin, or compliment me. So metadata management is actually, it's part of data governance. So with metadata management, you want to collect and give data to your data. So you would like to identify the data, for example, who is owning this data, who's responsible for the data, where is the data stored, what is linked with this data. So that's all metadata, which is stored and is part of the data governance, but the data governance is much broader than only metadata management, isn't it, Martin?
I completely agree.
Okay, good. So, no new questions appear. So I would like to thank all of you once more. If you have any questions or feedback, please contact one of us. Our details are on the screen. Later today, by the latest tomorrow, we will send you the recording as well. And yeah, please feel free to ask any questions if needed. Many thanks, all of you, and maybe see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you.